Just wanted to give you guys a quick reminder, if you guys love my videos and want to support me, check out compassion-teas.com. Link is at the end of the video.
All right, this is John Colin with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you, and I'm here today outside Orlando, just a short drive away in Howie in the Hills. I think that's what you call it. And the reason for this episode is I want to show you guys actually my favorite tree nursery here in the Orlando area, and for edibles as well, that I found in all my travels. And where we're at today, we're here at a natural farm, and this is fruit trees and edible plants, and that's all they sell. They don't like sell ornamentals, and they really specialize in the edible plants and the fruit trees, and they know pretty much all about it. Non-GMO, class in tours, chemical free farm, they ship. So that's the amazing thing, no matter where you guys live in the country, well, except for maybe California and certain other restricted places, they will ship any of the plants that you guys are gonna see in this episode right to your guys' door. So that's amazing. I'll put a link down to their website and their Etsy stores so you guys can purchase from them. Should you wanna get them their plants, I would encourage you guys to go to their website first. And if you see something that I'm showing in this video that's not on their website, hey, give them a call and they'll be sure to help you out. Their phone number is also down below. This is on State Route 19, I believe. And they also have USDA certified organic ginger and turmeric, right? And that's amazing. I learned all about turmeric this trip, talking to the owner. And before I go on, actually, I wanna give props to David the Good. Hey, David the Good, if you're watching, thanks, David the Good. He sent me the referral to hey, come and visit this place. So thanks, David. And for those of you guys that also live in Orlando and wondering, why, John, man, why don't you visit like Rob Greenfield? Well, I tried to connect with Rob, but he's out of town, so hopefully one of these days I'll connect with Rob. Anyways, this episode is all about this amazing nursery, and what I want to do in this episode is actually show you guys my favorite, like, three exotic fruits you guys could grow, the three more standard fruits that you could grow here in the Orlando area, because I like to have videos for the people of the area. Also, I'm going to share with you guys more information about turmeric, ginger, as well as sugarcane, and I'm gonna throw in a bunch of actually cool trees and other plants that they are selling here that I think you guys should grow. Anyways, let's go along on this learning journey here and show you guys more about a natural farm. All right, so now what you guys are looking at is as you drive in to the farm and nursery, you can actually park off to the actually the right side, and then this is what you see. I mean, this is like a modest farm slash nursery. Mostly a nursery, they sell fruit trees, they grow a few things, you know, to sell as a farm. But mostly if you're looking for edible plants and fruit trees here in Orlando, this is the place to come for sure. And this nursery is different than basically most other nurseries that I've ever visited for a couple reasons. Number one, you know, some of the plants here were started by the owner like over 10 years ago. Although this nursery has only been in business now for about 8 years at this time the video is being filmed. And like at least half of the things that they're selling here, they actually grew themselves. So they grew them here outside Orlando. So that means they may be more tolerant of the climates here because they were grew here. That being said, you know, if you get a tropical tree that expects not to be frosted, like some of the mangoes and other things, it will still die despite being grown here for many years. What I hope to do in this episode is, oh, the other thing that's really cool about this this nursery is that you know, it's a modest nursery. You know, they didn't build big buildings. There's no debt, there's no credit cards, no credit being used. And that's why they have slow and sustainable growth now over the last 8 years. And the other thing is I talked to the owner extensively, and I mean, his heart is really into growing these edible plants. He's really super passionate about it. And more importantly, he knows a lot about it. So I mean, if you need an expert about growing fruit trees here in Orlando, this is your guy, because he has lots of experience. Anyways, let's head in and show you guys more of the nursery. All right, so what you guys are seeing behind me is actually the main part of the nursery. And you're like, John, that doesn't look like much, man. Why are you making a video of this place? Well, you know what? I'll tell you guys. I thought when I drove up, I'm like, man, why did I come to this place? It looks just like a standard nursery. They don't really have that many things. I mean, they have like actually a fairly good variety of all the best things that'll grow here in Orlando. You know, like persimmons, plums, cherries, olives, pomegranates, loquats, nectarines, peaches, figs. They got like they like a lot of olives, citrus, lemons, all these kind of things, avocados. And I didn't really think it was much, but you know, like what they're showing in the front is only just a portion of their inventory. Actually, most of it is in the greenhouses in the back. So if you guys come here, don't just get out of your car, look, oh, they don't have anything good, and then leave. No, you want to come and talk to the owner or one of the workers. And the amazing thing about this nursery is that it's basically run by three people, two of which are part-time. So, I mean, this is like really a tight ship here at the nursery. And I mean, this is how I think business should be run. It should just be run slowly and expand slowly and not extend themselves into debt and be in it for the long haul. And, you know, create community relations. And anything I like about this nursery is that they're just not trying to sell you plants, right? They also have many different educational classes and programs to teach people, you know, how to grow some of these things themselves. So actually upcoming, I think maybe it's going to be in April, maybe a little bit later, is they're going to have an avocado grafting workshop. So they want you to bring in your sprouted avocado seeds where you have a little tree started, and then they're going to teach you guys how to graft an avocado, one of their special varieties, onto your basically rootstock, right? And they're not going to, you know, they might, and it's like amazing. So now your rootstock, they might have like some random tree is going to have like a really good variety that will perform, you know, better here in the Orlando area. So yeah, the classes are instrumental. The other thing that's going to happen soon, hopefully, is they're putting in a barn. And, you know, that's still, you know, been a construction project. And that's where they hope to have, you know, the classes indoors inside a barn, have a little bit of office space, also have a commercial kitchen to prepare food and probably do even more classes than they do now, just literally out in the middle of the field. So anyways, I think I want to get started and show you guys actually the greenhouses, because that actually is the most impressive to me, or the hoop houses. All right, so now we're in one of the hoop houses, and actually they have basically five hoops, and it's like one big house. And this is where the magic happens. Literally in this area, as I'll show you guys, they actually propagate some of the different plants from seed and from cuttings that you will end up buying. And actually, as I said, 50% of the plants that they sell here are actually grown here. And then behind me, you guys can see, oh wow, and I'm standing in the citrus area. I love the smell of the citrus buds or the flowers. And you guys can see they have all kinds of different plants. Now, you know, it is the winter time here in February here in Orlando. And, you know, this nursery will sell things that won't grow well outside. So like if you bought a mango tree here, you planted it outside with no protection and it got too cold, it's a goner. So you want to make sure, you know, and ask the owner or one of the employees, like, hey, will this do good and survive outside year round? Because I would hate for you guys to buy an expensive big tree, you plant it outside, and in the first year, because you forgot to protect it, you're away on vacation, you know, there's a freak snowstorm in Orlando, if that ever happens, you know, and you lose your trees, that's no fun. So, you know, that's why I'm going to focus this episode around trees that will do, you know, unless there's some weird weather event, meaning gets too cold, trees anyways, the fruit trees that I'm going to be talking about will do well. I will also be mentioning later in the video some of my favorite vegetables that you guys should grow and should be growing that are perennial vegetables, you know, provided it doesn't freeze, will also do well. So actually, let's go on the journey and maybe we'll do a hand cam shot of showing you guys what it looks like in here. All right, so walking inside the hoop house here is just really nice, man. Like one of these days, I wish to have a hoop house this big, and I don't even know if I'll have a nursery or just grow things indoors. Actually, one of the things was he has five of these hoops and he was supposed to dedicate one whole hoop to just growing things in ground as actually as a demonstration, you know, part of the nursery, so people could see what the plants actually look like if they grew in the ground and were properly trained and trimmed, and they could do fruit sampling and tasting and all this kind of stuff. Although he's a plant hoarder like I am, so he planted too many plants, although he's working on, you know, planting more in the ground. So I mean, here's like lychees. Yeah, I mean, just he has so many different things: lychees, star fruits. He has coffee trees, and over on this side, he basically has all the plant starts that are done from seeds and cuttings. I mean, look, he's making his own avocado rootstock. These are Florida-grown avocados that basically he's sprouting and making into trees, and then he's gonna graft on like good varieties. So, I mean, there is a lot of hard work that goes on here behind the scenes that you guys would never know. I mean, you guys are getting the behind the scenes tour because he gave me behind the scenes tour, and I wanna show you guys what goes on. You know, some of this work is not difficult, but some of it, you know, you will need certain, you know, you'll need the genetic diversity to do all this, you know, so you can't make your own sugarcane plants if you don't have sugarcane in the get-go, right? He starts many things from seeds and, you know, a lot from cuttings as well. And this is basically how it works. And he will not sell a plant before it's time. He will let them get big, nice and established before he's selling you something that he rooted out. So I really like that a lot. And over on this side, yeah, just a lot more. I mean, you could just see the aisles and aisles and aisles of plants. Here's something that does pretty good, the passion fruit. I mean, there's so many different things. I could be here all day. Papayas, although papayas can grow here. You know, if it gets too cold, they're gonna get hurt, you know? So that's not something I'm gonna recommend in this video. Oh, he has a miracle fruit. So these are amazing. If you have a, I don't know that I'd grow these outside because these also could be hurt by the cold weather, but he's got some really nice specimens. And here's actually a coffee. Grow your own coffee. Might even have to grow that indoors or have a nice greenhouse. And here, check this out, man. This is pretty amazing when he was showing me these guys. Like, I've been to Hawaii, I've seen pineapple fields, but look at these pineapple plants. I mean, these guys are pushing, some of them are pushing 6 feet. They're 5-6 feet tall. That's one plant. This is a testament to the good growing practices that he has, as well as, you know, the organic fertilizer with mycorrhizae and rock dust that he uses that hopefully I'll have time to cover later in the episode. No, these large pineapples are not for sale, but he will sell you these small ones. And these small ones are the same exact varieties that he's growing next door that are huge. Of course, he has other things like the sugar cane that he will sell you as well. And actually, as we're talking about sugar cane, actually, I wanna go ahead and show you guys actually the sugar cane patch he's growing. All right, so now we're here at the back of the nursery, and as you guys can see, they have lots of more trees and plants. He's growing a lot of nasturtiums for some upcoming shows, and then he has basically an orchard of olive trees that are just grown in nice, I think they're like 100-gallon pots. And so he will have you pick olives, you know. Olives to me are like a Mediterranean climate fruit, like you think maybe California or something, but man, he's grown them successfully here. And he has your own you pick olives. Anyways, I'm coming to the back corner here to show you guys actually his sugarcane patch, because it's one of the plants, edible plants, that I believe you should grow here in Orlando area. All right, so what you guys are seeing behind me is basically a little plot of sugarcane. This is the same sugarcane he's been growing actually 10 years at his residence. And basically he just takes cuttings off of them and makes more of them, right? And this is a patch that really, to me, looks pretty much unattended. I mean, they grow up, he harvests some of them, they fall down, and basically it has a natural mulch of sugarcane down below. And sugarcane is one amazing food. You know, I would consider sugarcane a superfood, but there's no legal definition of superfood. But I consider it a superfood because it's in the grass family plants. The grass family plants can absorb up to 90 different trace minerals. And because sugarcane is a grass and he's actually put in the azomite or A to Z of minerals, they can have potentially up to 70 minerals right here because that's the fertilizer he's using. So they're really nutritious. You think, John, but sugarcane, man, that's what they make sugar out of. White sugar, that's bad. Well, I agree with you. White sugar is bad. But if you get the sugar out of the sugarcane, the sugar in the sugarcane, that if you took a piece and just chewed it, you know, it would taste mildly sweet, right? Orange juice is sweeter than sugarcane juice, right? And most of you guys had orange juice for breakfast today or something. And in addition, there's all kinds of different vitamins, phytochemicals, antioxidants, and even there's nutritive benefits of the sugarcane wax. This is the waxy coating on the outside of the sugarcane. No, that's not any kind of pesticide spray, at least at this farm. The white stuff on the outside is basically a wax coating the sugarcane makes on its own to protect itself from the elements, right? And they've done studies, I think, in Europe where they isolate the wax and feed it to people as a supplement, and they get some kind of health benefit. I forget what it was. But sugarcane is one of my favorite foods, and I wish I could grow it like they grow it here. I mean, this is pretty much unattended, in my opinion. They could probably fertilize it a little bit better and probably water a little bit more and probably be like a lot nicer, thicker stalks. But even in a container, they have some containers over there, and they're just growing the sugarcane in the container. And so we are here in February, and I don't know how cold they got this year, but you know, sugarcane, it doesn't like super hard cold frosts. It won't make it, but you know, the root may stay alive. But nonetheless, the climate here is, I mean, it'd be better in Miami, but you could get away with growing some sugarcane here unless you have some real cold weather. So I'd recommend you guys to grow it, especially your land in the country here is pretty cheap. I would put a large patch in. And if you're in the city and you don't have a lot of land, I would dedicate a good space for sugarcane so you could basically grow your own sugarcane and juice it and have literally the best, one of the best beverages on the planet, just fresh sugarcane juice. All right, so now I'm back in the greenhouse, and actually I just wanted to show you guys actually the sugarcane. So they actually just did these cuttings today, and sugarcane is so easy to propagate. It's insane. So I mean, you need to get your own plants so you could propagate them, you could sell them, give them to friends, you could actually grow more for yourself. And I mean, literally all they do is they have some good organic soil that they bring in, and they just take a piece of the sugarcane, they cut it, and you got to make sure that it has a couple nodes sticking out. And let me show you guys the buds. I'll show you guys a good example of the buds and what's going to happen here. So here's one that has like a bud on it. And what happens is right at these bud points right there, you guys can see, this will actually start to grow roots on its own. They don't use any kind of rooting hormone here for sugarcane, it's not needed. This little bud will start growing into a big plant, and it'll just start growing, and within maybe like a month, I mean, this will be like 2 feet tall. And they're gonna make sure that these get up to nice size for, I mean, you guys could buy cuttings, but I always encourage you guys actually not to buy cuttings, buy rooted plants. Why? Because rooted plants are a lot harder to kill. You gotta really kind of work hard to kill a rooted sugarcane. But if it's not rooted and you have to do the rooting, if it doesn't have the right environmental conditions, you put it too much water, you put not enough water, it's not gonna root properly for you. So super simple and super easy. And as you guys can see, they have lots of cuttings of all different kinds of things, you know, mulberries, and I don't even know, like, they even do cuttings of tomatoes. But yeah, sugarcane, one of my favorite plants for sure. And that's definitely one you guys wanna grow if you guys live here. And even if you don't live here, this nursery, as I said early in the intro, they will ship to you. So you could buy sugarcane and have it shipped to you. That being said, do not let it freeze. It's probably good to grow in a big pot, grow it outside in the summertime, bring it into the wintertime. It does not like the cold. Now, sugarcane takes a nice long time, for at least a year, to get a nice size and to harvest of good quality, so that it's sweet. I've grown sugarcane before in a season, and it got pretty big, but I harvested it, and it wasn't really that sweet, but there was a lot of good water in there. So yeah, I would encourage you guys, actually, if you live in like a, you know, Orlando, more south, maybe like South Texas, Southern California, you know, those kinds of places, or Phoenix, those kind of places, sugarcane will probably grow really well. All right, so what I want to get into now are my top three no-brainer fruit trees that are exotic that you can grow here in the Orlando area. And the first one, of course, is the avocado. I mean, a no-brainer, if you guys live here in Orlando, you should have an avocado. Why should you grow an avocado? Number one, I don't know if you ever priced avocados lately, but they are expensive. You know, they could run $1.50, $2, maybe even more, depending on the time of season. But here in this climate, you could easily grow them, right? And some of these plants, the trees that they're selling here, are hardy down to 15 degrees, it says, 15 to 18 degrees cold hardiness. Now, the trick with that is, this is the cold hardiness when it's fully mature, right? If it's young, a baby, it's not gonna take that kind of weather. You know, I would protect your baby avocados from freezes until it gets more established, you know, at least 2 to 3, maybe even more years old from the time you get it from a nice established, 5 gallon pot or 7 gallon pot you would actually buy here. And they have lots of different varieties here. I'll recommend some of the ones that are most cold tolerant. So whether you guys live here or in other places, these might be the varieties you could get. That being said, if you're in Michigan, you know, or like, you know, somewhere where it really gets cold, like, oh, but John, I'm in Michigan, it only gets down to like 20 degrees, probably gets colder than that, but I'm gonna get it. It's not gonna do well because it needs nice, more tropical-esque weather. Avocados originated in, like, you know, Mexico, Guatemala, like India, where it's, you know, it doesn't really get cold. Some of these have been bred to be a little bit more cold tolerant, but they won't take freezes at all. Maybe like a night of 15 once established won't hurt it, but if it was like, you know, 2 weeks of 15 degrees, that's not gonna be so good, right? But yeah, this is the perfect climate here. So anyways, actually my favorite is one I've never seen before. They have a nice poster here, Thompson Red. So that's actually a red fruit. So hopefully that's higher in nutrition. That's hardy to 24 to 28 degrees. But some of the ones you guys might want to purchase, actually one of the best producing ones here at the farm, and maybe I'll take you guys out there in a little bit. They have some of these, they have actually most of these avocados in the ground, so you guys can see their form and how they grow. Is the Fantastique, or the Fantastic Avocado, cold hardy 15 to 18. This is the most productive avocado. Now, the other thing I wanna let you guys know, if you guys are getting a couple avocado trees, I would encourage you guys to get different varieties. Don't just get like, John, I'm getting 4 Fantastics, because you said that's gonna make the most. So that's been their experience here. And you can have a lot of fantastic avocados, and that's great. You're gonna have those between October and September. Meanwhile, I would buy one fantastic, and then I'd get like one Choquette, because the Choquette, that ripens in November to February. So now between November and February and August to September, you're covered. And then you could buy an avocado that's maybe like February to August, right? The Haas. I don't know if I'd buy Haas, they're so common. Maybe I'd find something else. August to September, oh no, we need something like early season. Here, winter Mexican, man, that fruits in November, December. When nobody else has avocados, you will, because you planted a winter Mexican. Anyways, I think some of my favorites are the poncho. I like the poncho. I saw those here. Those look like beautiful trees, 15 to 18 degrees. The Lilla was also a really good one, and the Joey. These are all the ones that are super cold hardy. The Lilla is good, maturity, July to September, and the Joey's August to September. So there's a little bit of overlap there. Plus, you can see the Joey actually has a nice larger seed. And actually, I like the Mexicola Grande because that is considered an edible skin avocado. So not only can you eat the inside flesh, but you can eat the skin, and it has a nice licorice flavor. So that's one of my favorite avocados to eat, is the Mexicola Grande. Eat the skin and all when it's totally ripe, man. It is so delicious. So the next no-brainer fruit tree that I want you guys to grow here, because it is, you know, exotic, abnormal, and you just normally don't find these fruits available anywhere. Plus, these have a nice purple skin. They're high in antioxidants, super healthy. This is called the Jabuticaba. This is like from South America. And basically it looks really funny because it makes these grape-like fruits that grow along the stem or the trunk of the tree. And this one will fruit multiple times a year. So some of these fruits will only produce like once a year, like the avocado. This one will produce multiple fruits a year. They're so delicious. And unless there's some weird cold spell, these guys are gonna grow great for you. They're very rarely bothered by any pests as well. So the next exotic fruit that I think you guys should grow if you guys live here in the Orlando area is a Barbados cherry, right? They have Suriname cherries, which are similar to Barbados cherries, but unlike the Suriname cherry, the Barbados cherry will fruit multiple times a year. So a tree that fruits multiple times a year is a tree that gives you more fruit. In my opinion, that's a lot more valuable fruit than a tree that just makes fruit one time a year. These grow quite good here, and the trick with the Barbados cherry is that, you know, you want to basically prune them back after the last frost. You want to prune them back because once you prune them back after the last frost, that's going to encourage budding and fruiting for you. They're letting these guys grow out a little bit longer to make sure that all signs of frost have passed before they clip this out, because you wouldn't want to clip this now, get budding, and then it frosts, and then you lose all your buds, which means you're going to lose all your fruit. So, I mean, these are the kind of tips and techniques that they could give you guys here, because they've been growing, you know, these fruit trees for many years on site. So now I want to show you guys actually real quick, like their pots. So, I mean, this is like a standard, I don't know, 5 gallon pot or whatever. And if you look, you don't see the dirt. And so when I walked in the nursery, this is the first nursery I've ever been to that, I mean, pretty much methodically, every pot that's in a selling condition has one of these basically coconut coir fiber, mats on the top. They just pretty much look like this. And I asked him, like, well, why do you guys do that? He says, because, you know, if we didn't do that, we would get a lot of weeds. So, you know, here they don't want their fertilizer mix, their organic fertilizer mix they're using to grow weeds in the pot you guys are selling. They want all the nutrients available for the tree so the tree could grow nice, big, and healthy. Plus, they want to minimize their labor of having to go around like thousands of trees and plants they have here pulling weeds, so it's easier for them to just put one of these guys on. So this way they don't grow weeds, because the soil they're using is organic soil mix. Now the other thing, the reason for this is, to a lesser degree, is because of the evaporation loss. So this acts like a kind of a mulch and helps with some of the evaporation of the moisture, so it keeps the water in the pot longer. So once again, your tree can be healthier. I also asked the owner if this can help with like fungus gnats or other kind of things growing in your soil, because now they actually can't get in the soil to lay their eggs or do whatever. And so he said that could be possible too. So I think this is quite cool, and you know, you guys don't have to pay extra for this service. And I will say that the prices here are quite affordable, especially seeing that they grow half of the trees here on site. I think the next thing I want to get into is actually go ahead and show you guys the three temperate climate crops that you should grow here in Orlando and will grow in also many other places in the country. Some more temperate climate fruit trees I want you guys to grow here, and will also grow in many other places of the country, although might not grow everywhere. Number one is this deciduous tree that loses its leaves in the wintertime, but will, in the nice growing season, grow really lush. This is one of the first things of fruit. As I'm sitting here, it's already starting to fruit, and I wish these guys were already ready. And this is one of my favorite fruits. It's a mulberry, and you know, you could go to the store till you're blue in the face. You will probably never find fresh mulberries for sale at a standard grocery store. Why? Because they are so perishable, I swear. You pick it, and within like 3 hours, they're kind of almost mush. So you gotta basically pick them and eat them. Or if you don't, the birds are gonna get them. So then you're feeding wildlife, right? But anyways, they have many varieties of the mulberries here, including like the everberry. They have a local black mulberry, the Persian, which I like. I think they're the long ones. That's the one I would actually get myself. And actually, that's the tree that I have. Mulberries are so delicious. They're also super anthocyanin rich because they have those nice deep purple pigments. Definitely one of the easiest fruit trees to grow, and also one of the healthiest. So another more normal fruit I want you guys to grow here in Orlando, because you're kind of right on the cusp. This is not like a super, you know, tropical place, like maybe like down in Miami, because you do get some chill hours and you can get cold. So it's kind of like the best of both worlds almost, but you can't grow super tropical stuff. But on the other hand, you could grow something like this, which is a peach. Now this is a special variety of peach from the university that will do well here in this particular climate, right? There's not a lot of chill hours. I mean, you guys get a lot of chill hours in like Michigan. It's probably still chilly outside right now. But here in, you know, Central Florida, I mean, today is like in the 60s. I'm in a t-shirt, you know, it's wonderful. And I love it. Maybe it's actually 70s actually. And even now in February, the peaches are now blooming, and hopefully there's no more frost and all these will turn actually into fruit. But the reason for the peach tree is because, you know, for me, I get really upset when it's summertime and I see peaches in the store and I go to buy one and pick it up and eat it. They're like hard as rocks. They're picked too early. You will never taste what a peach should taste like if you've only ever eaten them from the grocery store. So, I mean, what's the solution? The solution is buy them at the farmer's market. Well, that's better than the grocery store, but still, some farmers will pick them too early, and some farmer's markets aren't even farmer's markets. They're just selling you stuff that they bought wholesale. Depends on where you are in the country. But the surefire way to, you know, counter all that is to grow your own, because then you could harvest and pick each fruit at its peak ripeness, and you will have some of the sweetest, bestest fruits they've ever eaten. And you know, a ripe peach could be so delicious. So yeah, grow your own. Now I will say that, you know, the peaches are not one of the things they grow on site. They get them in, and then once they come in, then they grow them all through natural methods. So if that bothers you, they have plenty of other things that they grow here on site that have been raised since a child from organic, natural methods. That being said, you know, I wouldn't have a problem buying one of these peach trees here, because even under organic standards of like, you like, John, but I only buy organic fruit. I'm a snob like that. You know, what you don't know is if like the organic grower can't get organic seed for the plant that they're growing, they could start with conventional seed. So, I mean, I kind of see that as, hey, if you start with a conventional, you know, a peach, and then you plant it, and then from then on, you raise it right, I would consider it organic. It's like if you adopted a kid and maybe he was had some issues and the parents were on drugs and stuff, and then you get him and then you just feed him healthy food. I mean, that's like way better. So it's kind of like that with plants. Maybe that was a bad analogy. So the last temperate climate fruit tree I want you guys to grow here in Orlando that'll do really well is this guy. This is the Scarlet Beauty Plum, right? Plums, they're in a stone fruit, much like the peaches. And you know, if you go to the store to buy a plum, they're always picked hard, they're shipped hard. They just don't have the full sweetness, the full flavor. I mean, some of the best plums I've ever eaten, I was like literally climbing up into a plum tree in California. And I mean, they were falling off in my hand and they would literally melt and dissolve in my mouth because they were that juicy and that ripe. And if you depend on grocery stores or even farmers markets to get your plums ripe, it ain't gonna happen. Grow your own. It also happens to be one of the easiest fruit trees to grow here in Orlando. So aside from this being just a standard like fruit tree and edible nursery, right? They're also growing certain crops as a farm and selling them. And actually the two crops that I'll be sharing with you guys today, the turmeric and ginger, are both certified as USDA organic. They've been growing these for the last 10 years actually, and they've expanded actually in a big way. So if you guys are looking for good turmeric or ginger, you know, rhizomes to start with. You guys could buy them here. I think they're out of ginger maybe for the season, but they have plenty of turmeric that you guys could order online on their website or at their Etsy store. I would encourage you guys to, you know, buy at least 2 pounds, because then you get a better price. And or if you're really gonna go for it, hey, buy 10 pounds, plant some for yourself, and then, you know, eat the rest. Turmeric is one of the best foods for you. And actually the best way to store it, I found, is if you're in a dry climate, just leave it out. You know, mine, I leave on the counter, a well-vented place. Don't put it in a plastic bag, don't put it in the cold. And, you know, in my dry climate, it'll start growing and sprouting out the little, you know, growths on there. And then sometimes I plant it and sometimes I just juice it anyways. I guess the other way to store it too is just put it in some dirt. I mean, that's where turmeric is meant to be stored. It's not meant to be stored in a fridge. It's like 40 degrees. I mean, it is a tropical plant after all. So anyway, what you guys see behind me may not look super impressive, because there's mostly like this field that they are converting now into more organic turmeric, because they got like orders from pharmaceutical companies or something like that that want to process it into some kind of who knows what. But you know, you don't have to like, you know, take drugs, in my opinion. You can just eat food. I mean, after all, Hippocrates said, let food be thy medicine and medicine be thy food. And turmeric is one of the most healing foods on the entire planet that most people, unless you're Indian and eat a lot of curry, you're just basically not even eating and you're avoiding. I would encourage you guys when eating the turmeric to also eat it with like some avocado and some pepper, which will increase the absorption of some of the phytonutrients in the turmeric, okay? And then anyways, behind me, they basically have two beds, and these two beds, I think the beds are 8 feet wide by 160 feet long. I mean, those are pretty long beds, and they basically planted turmeric every 12 inches, right, away from each other. And in that one bed, so if you had space here in Orlando, had this much space, 8 foot by 160 feet, you could gross about 1,000 pounds of turmeric. I don't know, do the math. If you sell turmeric for like 10 bucks a pound times 1,000 pounds, what's that, like $10,000 in that much space? I mean, is that more money than like, I don't know. But anyways, the turmeric takes about a good 6 to 8 months to grow to full maturity. So easily here in the warm Florida sun, it'll grow great and produce a good yield. It starts to bust out and growing up, whether it's in a pot or whether it's in the raised bed. It'll start growing around March, and within like a month or two, it'll get 2 feet, and then by 6 months, it'll be like 6 feet tall. And then basically by the time it gets December, it gets cold, it's basically gonna turn brown, knock itself over, like I'm gonna show you guys, and basically then you're ready to harvest. So one cool thing about this farm and nursery, they will have turmeric year round, because I know I made other videos before at other farms with turmeric, and they ran out after, you know, I put a video up about them. So this is a place that has assured me they will have turmeric year round for you guys to buy that are good to grow. I mean, you could go down to your grocery store and buy turmeric. The problem with that is that most imported turmerics can be irradiated, or they be using chemicals or growth inhibitors or things that will prevent it from sprouting, because if the turmeric sprouts on the way to the store and shipment, and most turmeric is actually imported from out of the country, from what I've seen, even organic stuff, you know, it's not gonna sprout, because they don't want it sprouting, because that's to the farmer, that's going bad. They're losing their profits, right? Me, on the other hand, I want the turmeric that's gonna sprout. I want it to not be chemically treated, and they definitely don't treat any of their turmeric here. So let's take a look at what the turmeric looks like after 7 months or 8 months of growth. All right, so now I want to show you guys actually what it looks like when they harvested turmeric. They basically harvested that side and left all the top growth on the top, and that's basically to protect it from, if it should get cold, it gives some layers of protection so that the turmeric root does not freeze. It will not take a freeze, it'll freeze and then basically rot on you. One of the things I like about this raised bed is basically they're just reusing parts of a greenhouse or a hoop house that basically fell over in the hurricane. It's all aluminum, so it will not rust. And that's literally what they're growing in. In addition, they have this nice, really loose, fluffy, organic soil. It looks amazing to me. They're not growing in the standard, you know, Florida sand. And they supplement this with their organic fertilizer, plus the azomite and the mycorrhizae, which I'll be sure to show you guys in a little bit. Anyways, we're gonna go ahead and dig some of this up for you guys. And look at this, you can dig this up and basically it's just one big root mass. And we'll shake that down a little bit. And you can see they got all the nice turmeric in here. I mean, I'm not gonna pick this totally off, but here's a piece. I mean, this is like some really nice, deep orange turmeric. Super good for you. And so yeah, they planted, wow, it smells really good too. So they plant this basically every 10 inches, And then each one they plant like will produce, well, will either double or triple in 7 months. So if they plant like 1 pound in a bunch, then that 1 pound will go to 2 to maybe 3 pounds, depending on the plant and all this kind of stuff. So, I mean, that's literally doubling your investment or tripling your investment. Such an effective use of space. And I think, you know, especially if you guys are trying to be a home farmer, you know, it's really important to try to maximize your revenue. And I think with the turmeric, if you live in a climate that'll grow well, I mean, I think that's one of the best crops you could grow, because also it stores well, unlike many other crops. I mean, think about trying to store, I don't know, Barbados cherries. Like, those guys are not going to store. Try to store mulberries, you can't, but turmeric will store easily, so you could have your money in them and then ship them out as needed. So I think the farmer is quite wise to grow the turmeric and ginger and get it certified organic for that, all the health food people and people that want to buy, you know, the ginger or turmeric to eat or to process or to actually grow themselves into their own plants can do so. So what you guys are looking at now is more turmeric, right? So they'll harvest all the turmeric that you guys saw in those big, large beds, right? And then they're gonna plant this in its place. They don't just take some of the turmeric out that they grew in there and then leave them in there, throw them back, because then what happens is those turmerics have to basically make a whole entire root system and get developed. And, you know, they want to basically jump the gun, right? And have a jump on the season and have nice established plants to put in there that are already well developed and well rooted out to grow into their crop. And that's the amazing way how they're able to basically get, you know, the crop in 6 to 8 months. If you try to start from little roots, you know, you're not going to get as much production out of it as if you start from, you know, productive plants already. So as you guys see here, they basically have like all these 3 gallon pots right here, and they basically let these grow. They got up to 6 feet tall last year. I think these are like maybe 2 years old, a couple years old. 6 feet tall, they basically folded over, and now they have basically these plants in the 3 gallons, and this pot is actually falling apart. Oops. And you guys can see, like, you guys see all the roots in there. I mean, this is a nice established root system. There's turmeric already growing in here. And basically what they're gonna do is they're gonna take one of these pots and plant them every 10 inches in that big raised bed to get the kind of numbers and production that they do. You know, and having a nursery like this, they're able to do that because they know how plants work. They will propagate and grow all these plants, and they'll take roots from this year's crop, grow those out a couple years before they put them into the thing. So basically they're actually growing several year old crops already in their main bed. So they just get more explosive, faster growth, which means, you know, in the end, producing more turmeric that they can sell. Now, here's the thing why I wanted to include this part of the video for you guys out there, because most people, when they grow turmeric like me, right, they just try to buy the rhizomes and they try to plant them and then they try to get them to sprout and grow. Now, that's a big process. You know, some, you know, the ones here should sprout and they should grow unless you maybe water them too much, it's not the right temperature, all these kind of things, right? So once again, I always encourage you guys to be safe than sorry. And, you know, personally, instead of just buying turmeric to grow from him, you know, he sells these whole plants. You could buy one of these pots and he will ship you this whole pot here with already an established root system, already turmeric that has been off to the races, that have been grown for 2 years, a lot harder to kill, and it also means that you're gonna get better production out of it. So, I mean, the cost of these, I think, are about twice as much as if you bought like a pound of roots. Don't quote me on that. But you're gonna be off to the races faster, and you're gonna get a higher harvest sooner. You know, actually, that being said, I'd probably order a little bit of both. I'd order this stuff to plant in my garden. I'd order some of the other stuff to actually eat because it is so good for you. And maybe just experiment with seeing if you guys could get some of those rhizomes to root for yourself. So the other shade house next door actually had the turmeric, which I think everybody should grow out there. I mean, especially if you guys live in Orlando, it's another one of those no-brainer crops that you guys should grow. And if you live in other parts of the country, yeah, experiment it, play with it, try to grow it. You know, I grow turmeric in a big pot, and that way I could bring it into my greenhouse, which I did in the winter time, so it doesn't like get too cold and freeze the roots out, which then they will rot. And you could do that. The other one that you guys should grow, that's another no-brainer for here in Orlando and also other places, can be ginger. Now, if I had to choose between turmeric and ginger, which one would I choose? That's a tough question. I mean, ginger is also one amazing plant. It might even be more anti-inflammatory than the turmeric root is on some levels. And it doesn't stain my juicer as bad either when I'm juicing it. But generally, I'll make a juice with ginger and turmeric. So I take both. I don't discriminate against one or the other. I'll use some carrots, like purple carrots usually, some beets, and some pineapple is my normal juice that I like to make in the morning. And plus, I'll go out and harvest greens from my garden. But yeah, ginger, another amazing crop that's gonna grow really well here in this particular climate and similar climates, also tropical climates. Pretty much the same as turmeric, right? Grow in a pot, bring inside. They sell the roots here. I think they might be out, although they will be selling the plants in smaller pots, so you guys could buy those and then grow them. And these, the ginger and the turmeric, are 100% certified organic, whether you're buying the tuber, the roots themselves, the rhizomes, or actually the plants. Now, this is what happens, and this is why they cover all their plants you guys saw in the nursery, right? Of course, before they ship these to you guys, before you buy these, they'll come in here and basically weed all this stuff out here that's been growing in here rambunctiously in their super nutritious soil. All right, so I've been walking this nursery and farm up and down, back and forth, multiple times to get the right shot for you guys in the right order. So I thought I'd take you guys on a little tour of what it looks like when I'm walking around. Yeah, they have just lots of fruit trees. There's some nice mulberries. They have lots of olives. So many different things, more than just what is in the front. So if you don't see what you want in the front, once again, ask. And then, oh, here's all the trees they have for demonstration purposes. So they don't have like a ton of trees, but they have plenty planted, including one of my favorites, actually the loquat that's fruiting. And actually the trick is, they have all loquat trees that have been grafted. So these will fruit pretty much from the time you buy them. And if you planted a loquat from seed, it might take 7 years. Here they have basically all kinds of different avocado trees planted, so you guys can see the growth habits of them. And I want you guys to notice like some of their practices on the bottom, right? They do mulching. You know, unlike most nurseries or even farms that will use Roundup and spray the ground with Roundup, which, you know, has been considered a probable carcinogen from the World Health Organization or something. They don't do any of that Roundup stuff here because they grow natural and organic here. You know, to prevent weeds by the base of the tree, what they do is they just pile up organic matter, you know, whether that's a coconut, coir mats, you know, big branches of trees or leaves or other stuff down below, so that they don't get the weeds. And of course, you know, in between the aisles, you know, they don't spray anything either. They have a mower that they'll come mow all this area with. Now I'm headed down here because I actually want to show you guys the one tomato I think you guys should grow here in Florida. All right, so the one tomato I think you guys should grow in Florida, whether you're in like Miami or here in Orlando or potentially even other places, is this guy. Because this guy, from what I hear, is a native of Florida. It's actually known as the Florida Everglades tomato, you know. And I like this tomato because it is hardy, right? We're here in February. I don't know if they had a frost in here, but this tomato is basically still producing flowers. It's got green fruits, and it's even got some ripe fruits on here. And actually, I think this is my first tomato of the year because I don't live in a place that I could grow tomatoes. Mmm. Wow. These are packed full of flavor. This is like more of a wild plant. And in addition, in general, but not all cases, most wild plants that have been not as hybridized for their sweetness or for being super huge or big will have more nutrition, phytochemicals and antioxidants in them than hybridized versions. But you could hybridize things for nutrition, but unfortunately, that's the exception to the rule. I would encourage all you guys to read a book that I read, or actually I didn't read it, I listened to it on audiobook because I like to listen to books while I'm gardening many times, called Eating on the Wild Side. And they go into all the different crazy tomato varieties. And in general, the smaller tomatoes have more antioxidants than the large ones. And so if you guys are lucky enough to live in Florida, you guys could grow these Everglades tomato that will just grow like a weed, literally. I mean, they do grow a weed, like a weed, in the Everglades. Anyways, I want to show you guys the two ways they sell the Everglades tomato for you guys here. You could buy it from seeds that they started from the fruit that they grew here on site, or you could actually buy it from cuttings that they also done from the tomatoes here on site. So here at a natural farm, you guys could buy the Everglades tomato from seedlings, which are right here. These are still small. They're gonna probably up-pot these into like larger sizes in a little bit. There's actually some across the way that are a lot bigger into a nice 4-inch pot. So you could buy them this way from seed, or you could buy them this way from cutting. So literally for tomatoes, it's super easy. They basically just take a cutting off the plant of the right girth. Make sure it's the right girth. It can't be too thin. It's gotta be the right size. Maybe the size, I don't know, like a small girl's pinky. Not too small. The pencil size. So at least pencil size, number two pencil size, or thicker would be good. Thinner, you don't want to do that. The cutting might not take. And they basically just put it in their organic potting or their organic mix here. and then they keep on a heat mat, and then they basically grow roots, and then they grow into a whole plant. So I don't really have a, you know, wait, I could pull out one of these guys. So I want to show you guys the difference between these guys. So the question is, John, man, they got both of them. They got cuttings and they got rooted plants. Which one do I get? So, you know, I'm going to say, like, for those of you guys that like have tomatoes at home, you guys could do your own cuttings. Do that, because that's a very fast way to multiply your plant. That being said, I think the best way to buy your tomatoes would be from the seedlings, because this has an established root system that grown from a seed into roots. It's going to have a probably better developed root system than one that was just grown with a cutting that actually had to grow roots. I think it's going to be more stable. This is just my personal opinion. So if you do buy Everglades tomato here, yeah, say I want the ones from seed. So the last category of plants I want to share with you guys today are actually the leafy greens. And perennial leafy greens, or more perennial-ish leafy greens that'll live multiple years, or at least a fairly long season here in the climate in Orlando, right? I think it's quite sad that many farms and permaculture, you know, orchards and food forests I visit, right? They have lots of fruit trees, and they have pretty good diversity of fruit trees in many cases. But in my personal opinion, IMO, and that's not like IMO microbes, they're missing out on the greens, you know, as an understory, as a cover, and also to produce some of the most nutritious foods on the planet. The leafy greens, I mean, my channel is called Growing Your Greens, and I didn't just randomly pick Growing Your Greens as a name. I chose that specifically because I want all you guys out there, as much as I like fruits, and all I had today was fruit so far, you know, greens are super important for our diet, and if you're deficient in greens, in my opinion, you will be compromising your health. My goal is to eat 2 pounds of leafy greens a day, and depending on the season, the time of year, you know, I'm always eating different ones, whatever's in my garden. Actually, just yesterday, before I left the house, I was eating arugula. I was eating actually my green tree collards, which are totally amazing. They're totally sweet. I was dipping them in guacamole, as well as my red lettuces, which are so good, basically washed by the water of the rain, because it was raining yesterday. But anyways, the greens here that you guys want to grow, and hopefully they're going to get up into production in these, because I didn't really see on any of the tables, but they can easily do it. This is their mother plants, and this is the Gianera procumbens, also known as longevity spinach. This is one of my favorite plants to grow. You know, I have to protect this in the wintertime from the frost, but this guy can handle down to 32 degrees without any issue. But if it gets below that, it will freeze out. So you guys want to protect this or put it in a place where it's going to stay warmer in your yard, and you'll basically have greens to eat year-round. I mean, this plant is so tolerant, it even handles 100-plus degree weather. The next tree that's a no-brainer here, or leafy green for Orlando and many other climates, is the moringa. So they have lots of moringa here. It's also known as the drumstick tree. It makes these delicious leafy greens to eat that have the same cancer-protective isothiocyanates as like the cruciferous family of plants. So they have like a nice strong kind of like a, you know, strong flavor that you might take getting used to. My favorite way is to juice it. If I remember, I'll post a link down below to a video where I actually juice moringa with celery and pineapple, which is one delicious recipe to really concentrate the nutrients you're gonna get out of the leaves and get all the nutrients out of the leaves into you. I've also like powdered the leaves in a dehydrator and turned them into a green powder that I can eat year round. Here in Orlando, I mean, just right outside the Hoophouse here, they have like, man, geez, it must've been like 15 feet pushing 20 feet tall moringas that basically grow year round. Now they get a little bit, you know, due to the cold, they don't like it too cold. They get some yellowing of the leaf, but they're still going strong and they'll continue to grow, you know, through basically year after year, unless it frosts. If it does frost, then basically in this climate, more than likely the root will stay alive and then basically it'll shoot up the following year. So the next leafy green I want you guys to grow is actually known as the cranberry hibiscus here. And you know, there's also a different one with the green leaves. It's like, I think the Jamaican sorrel. But I would prefer you guys grow this one because the other one is actually an annual, whereas this can be perennial in this climate. So it'll basically grow year round, provided there's no hardcore frost. You know, for me, this one grows as an annual because I get a frost and it just doesn't like the cold weather. So if you want to try to keep it alive year round, grow it in a pot. And you know, bring it indoors in the winter, bring it in a nice warm greenhouse that's not going to freeze for you guys. I like this plant because, you know, it has the leafy greens, which are actually a nice deep you know, purplish color, anthocyanin rich, that are super nutritious. Kind of tastes a little bit like sorrel, like lemony, so it's like great to add to salads, although I wouldn't make a salad out of the cranberry hibiscus leaves unless you're really into like a sour tasting stuff. But yeah, they have plenty of these guys, just like in the 4.5-5 inch pots here, available to even ship to you guys wherever you live. All right, so the last leafy green I want you guys to grow here in Orlando, and this one is a lot iffy in other places. Like for me to grow this plant, I have to bring it inside in the winter. It's actually growing in my bathroom, so hopefully I get no knocks on my door from the police from using a LED grow light that's usually used for growing medicinal herbs in my bathroom again. I'll put a link down below when the cops did come to my house and thought I was growing cannabis in the bathroom when I was growing a tree collard, which is actually another plant that they should be having here propagating and making available for you guys, both the green and the purple variety, although the green variety will probably do better here. That's a no-brainer. You guys got to get that tree collards. Actually, in most climates, zone 8 or above, maybe zone 7B. But this is another one you guys should get. They haven't started propagating this in any large way, but hopefully after my video today, they're gonna get a lot of requests, which means they're gonna get off their tushies and they're gonna start propagating this, which is super simple. Basically, you just do it from cuttings, and this is actually one really nice specimen. Looks like they've been pruning this back regularly, so there's lots of nice offshooting to make plants from. So they got like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I mean, they're just like probably like maybe 100 plants that they could make out of this one tree. I mean, literally like owning a nursery and doing cuttings and making more plants out of one. And this is like the mother stock is like printing your own money, but it's legal, right? But yeah, the katuk is amazing. We're gonna go ahead and try the katuk. The cool thing about katuk is you could just pick all these leaves and eat them. My friend says they taste like peanut butter. I don't know that I'd say peanut butter, but I would say they have like a nice nutty flavor. And the other thing you could do is you could just go ahead and pick the absolute tip tops, and then you could eat this just fresh and tender like baby asparagus. Wow. That's quite good. I miss the flavor of katuk. It's one of my favorite leafy greens in the world. Now, if you are growing katuk, right, you don't want to eat too much of this. Like, don't like juice it. Don't like eat it every single day. You may have some challenges or some naturally occurring toxins in katuk that in high amounts could be toxic to people. Now, that being said, if you have like a handful of leaves every few days, it's not going to be an issue. Or if you eat like a big side of katuk today and then you don't eat it for, several weeks, you're going to be fine. But just don't consume it any day, and this every day. And this is something I recommend for all your greens. And I always encourage you guys always to rotate your diet. Don't just eat the same thing every day, day in, day out. Switch it up. Like one of my games I like to play with myself is every day, John, you're gonna eat a different fruit. You're gonna eat a different vegetable. You're gonna pick something else. If you harvested the tot soil in your garden yesterday, you're gonna eat the red lettuce tomorrow. You're gonna eat the arugula the next day. You're gonna eat dandelion greens the next day. You're gonna have, I don't know what else is in my garden this time of year, collard greens the next day. Rotate through all the different greens that you get, you are growing and that you can source near you, so you don't get any toxic buildups of any one particular fruit or vegetable for that matter. So I think that's pretty much the whole episode for plant-wise, but I wanted to cover two more things before actually I interview the owner and actually the team here at the farm. And what I want to talk to you guys next is about the soil, right? The soil is probably the most critical factor when selecting or buying a fruit tree, or when you're filling your raised bed garden or planting a tree. You want to get the right soil and the best soil. So, I haven't researched in depth the soil here, in Orlando like I do in many places. but I can say that all the trees that they have planted here from the things that they started and they grew themselves, they look totally amazing to me. And that's only because of the soil they're using. They carefully selected and found the best soil in the area. They will also make this soil available for you guys by the half yard. I think it's $40 at present time. That may change. But this is the soil right here. And this is a nice rich mixture. Looks like it has some maybe some sand in there. Also, it has basically organic compost, Florida peat, and some pine fines in there. And so this is how they get the amazing growth with this organic soil mixture that they're using. Now, the other thing I want to talk to you guys about is the fertilizer they're using. So, many nurseries, might skimp on the fertilizer or use some kind of synthetic fertilizer that basically just gives a growth spurt to your tree. So have you guys ever bought like a tree from a nursery and then it looks pretty good, but you get it home and then you plant it and then it like dies soon after, or like it doesn't do well? and that's because maybe the fertilizer ran out. I mean, there's many reasons why a tree could die. But yeah, the synthetic fertilizer is not good for the long-term health of your fruit trees, in my personal opinion, once again. So I actually want to show you guys their special organic mix that they also make available. But also I'm going to show you guys actually how they make it. All right, so now we're literally at the checkout counter. This is like the Hoop House for checking out, where they got a scale and all that. They ring you up over here and all this stuff. And they got some of their USDA organic turmeric roots that you guys could buy right in here. And this stuff looks amazing. Look at how nice this washed turmeric. So this is how they're gonna sell it to you, all washed and ready to go. You know, if you guys wanna eat it, juice it, or even plant it, like let it like, start growing on its own and then start new plants out of it. That being said, I would encourage you guys to buy the potted plants that are already established. But actually, I didn't want to show you guys a turmeric right here. I want to show you guys actually the fertilizer they're using that makes this turmeric grow, as well as all the other potted plants on the property. So now I want to show you guys their special fertilizer mix that they recommend. Once you buy one of their fruit trees, they recommend that you use their fertilizer, because they have seen consistent results. You know, they get customers that come back and say, "We want more of your fertilizer because it works so well." And this is just basically the A Natural Farm organic fertilizer, and this is all purpose. They don't have like one recipe for mangoes and one for papayas and one for moringa. They basically use this on everything. It's nice and all purpose. And this is a non-GMO and chemical free. It's 626. And basically this contains a poultry manure, azomite, which are the trace minerals, mycorrhizae fungi, and magnesium crystals, right? And so they sell this stuff on their website pre-made for you guys. But I like to save you guys money. And if you guys want to do it yourself, I'm going to show you guys the ingredients they use, although I don't know their exact recipe, right? So they use this stuff. This is called, this is for professional use. So homeowners might not be able to find this. This is actually called the Armory Listed. So that's organic, fully organic. Sigma 626 plus myco. So that's the mycorrhiza. And that's just all natural granular fertilizer with mycorrhizae. And yeah, that's a Sigma 626 plus myco. That's pretty much it. So they use this. In addition, they will add also the azomite trace minerals. This is something I recommend you guys always add to all your fertilizer mixes, or just add to your raised beds. Put as much of it as you can. If it was me, I would probably put a 1-to-1 ratio. 1 pound of that, 1 pound of this. And then the last ingredient they use is actually just Epsom salt. So they get like a organic approved Epsom salt, organic listed Epsom salt, and definitely you don't want to like do a 1-to-1 ratio. You might want to put like a handful or two, go light on the Epsom salt. You don't want to put too much. That could not be good if you put too much, but you cannot overdo the azomite, right? So yeah, that's pretty much it for their fertilizer mix. That's how they get the amazing growth. Once again, good organic soil that they've sourced carefully, and this fertilizer mix, and just pure water, and of course all the love they put in their plants. So speaking about love, it's actually the day after Valentine's Day. We want to go ahead and interview the owner plus some of the employees here and talk to them more about the farm and nursery. So now I have the pleasure of introducing you guys to Luke, the owner and horticultural expert that's been in the horticultural business now for 25 years and actually into plants for now 40 years, and some of his staff here. And so Luke, who do we have here today with us?
All right, so we have Caitlin here. She's been with us for more than a year now. And so she helps the customers, give advice to the customers, and show them around, give the tour, and then works with us on growing the plants, putting up the plants, and taking care of all those plants. And then we have Raphael. Raphael has been with us, what, about 3 months?
Five months
now. And so he's a great addition to our team, knows a lot about the plants as well, gives a lot of advice to the customers. And so it's great to have him on board as well.
Cool. So I want to ask you, why do you work here? Or why did you choose to work here of all the places here in Orlando?
Sure. There's not a lot of places that really back, what they say they're doing. So here we really do everything organically. We really do try to take care of people and really do care about, making the world a more sustainable place. And so it's like a really great place to be involved every day and to get to practice what I really believe in and also get paid
Get paid, yeah. Getting paid is important, but also having fun at your work and liking your job, right? I mean, you're into horticulture, right? Don't you have some kind of nonprofit that you started to to further education and all this kind of stuff? You want to tell everybody about it?
Sure. So I'm also a project coordinator for Orlando Permaculture, which is a nonprofit. We do a lot of action days and educational workshops, as well as holistic cooking series in Orlando and the greater Central Florida area. So if you guys want to find out about that, you can go to our website, orlandopermaculture.com, or our Facebook.
Cool, cool. I'll post links down below if I remember. All right. So over here we got Raphael. So Raphael, why did you get a job here at a natural farm and education center?
I wanted to change like my way of living. That's basically why I'm here.
Cool, cool. So you really love the plants. Have you been involved with plants, you know, for many years? Because he's from Puerto Rico. You're from Puerto Rico, right?
Maybe like for 2 years, around 2 years.
Cool.
I've been involved in plants and other stuff with some friends.
Awesome. So what's your favorite fruit that they sell or they sell here?
My favorite fruit can be the mango.
The mango, yeah. Nom Dog, my mangoes are pretty good. Yeah. So Luke, I want to ask you some questions. So why did you decide to start this nursery of all the businesses in the world you could do? Because I know you have a horticulture degree and you also have a business degree, which is unlike most people that run nurseries, because I've seen nurseries that are just not really run efficiently. Like this thing, to me anyways, from as an outsider coming in, it looks like you're running it pretty tight.
Yes, I don't know if I run it pretty tight, but the main reason is I love fruits and I love plants in general, and I like when plants produce fruits and eat the fruits, and also I enjoy sharing our knowledge with the customers and people that are just trying to get involved. And it's just so amazing the results that you get with a plant when you can grow it yourself and how many fruits you can produce with the small space. So people sometimes are wondering how much space do I need to grow a fruit tree or 10 fruit trees. So it doesn't take a lot of space to yield a lot of fruits. So by a little bit of care and patience, you can get a lot of results and a lot of fruits. So that's why, you know, we grow all those different fruit trees, and we like to share our knowledge for free to the public when anyone comes here.
Cool. So the question I have for you, Luke, is, you know, why should somebody come here? Because I always encourage you guys to support your local nursery, especially this nursery. But I'm just going to put Luke on the spot here. So why should somebody come here rather than go to like a big box store to buy their fruit tree? Like what do you provide that's better than them, or is it better?
Yeah, the main reason why I think people should come here is because we only grow fruit trees and edible plants. So we're not trying to grow shrubs and trees and palms. That's our only plant family that we grow, just for producing fruits and vegetables and just leafy greens for people to eat. So by coming here, they get a wide variety of fruit trees, edible plants, vegetables, all year round. So all of our trees we offer all year round in a large variety of sizes. We have little plants up to huge specimen trees. So we have plants for all the budgets, different budgets. And mostly because we have the three of us that can provide the information, the knowledge for someone to be successful. So they come here and they know that either Caitlin, Raphael, or myself will guide them. And sometimes we tell people, you should not buy this tree, or you should not buy this tree now. Just wait before you buy the mango, wait until the end of March. And then this way you won't have to worry about the plant getting damaged by the cold. So that's the two reasons. The information that we provide for free to the public, and then the assortment and the variety of plants that we have here.
I think the other thing that's very important to me, Luke, and maybe you'll comment on this, is that, you know, you grow in organic methods here, right? You don't spray any kind of toxic pesticides. You use a certified organic fertilizer that I showed a little bit earlier. You want to talk about your commitment to organic and why this is so important to you and the nursery?
Yes, that's true. I should have brought that up. Yeah, so here, since we started about 8 years ago, we have not used a single drop of herbicide. We do not use any chemical fertilizer. We do not use any chemical pesticide or fungicide. So we grow everything naturally, and we just observe the plants and, you know, just work with nature and with the plants instead of trying to force nature into doing things that she doesn't want to do. So yeah, that's another good reason why people should come here, is it's a chemical-free place.
Yeah, I mean, after all, you guys are buying these plants because they only sell edibles, so that in my book, this is the kind of nursery you want to support, somebody doing good work to promote and propagate all these different kinds. I mean, how many different kinds of fruit trees and edibles do you actually sell here? Have you ever counted them all up?
I think we have about 80 or 90, or maybe more if you count the vegetables, probably close to 100 different types of edible plants and fruit trees and vegetables.
Yeah, I mean, that's a selection that you will just not find in any even local big box store or even any other nursery in the area that I'm aware of. Like, are there any other big nurseries that sell this many fruit trees, like specifically for Orlando?
I don't think so. You know, one of our specialties is avocado trees, which we have about 13 different varieties. So there are varieties that would be more susceptible to some areas, and then some that produce a quality of fruit that someone would like better than another person. So yeah, I don't think people can find that kind of assortment in another nursery around here.
Yeah, I mean, I think that the other thing that I really like about the nursery here is that they start, like, what, about half of the plants that you're selling here, you actually grew them yourself from the mother plants or from seeds, right? You want to talk about more about this?
Yeah, so about half of the plants we sell here have been started here. Like you said, from seeds, cuttings, or any other method. And then there are some other plants that we do buy at a young age from other nurseries, and then we babysit them and we step them up to bigger sizes so that we have big specimens that we didn't really grow ourselves from the get-go, but we grew from a young age, and then after that we grew them organically.
Right, so this tree behind me, which I should have mentioned in the video, because if you want to be my best friend, you want to grow this tree because it has one of my favorite fruits in the world that I'm not able to grow. You know, this is what you call it a strawberry tree, but also Brazilian
Jamaican cherry
or Montinga.
Montinga.
And so, like, this one's in a, what, is that a 100-gallon?
It's a 65-gallon.
65-gallon. And when did you get this, and how long has it been growing here in your greenhouse under the ideal care and situation?
Yeah, so these we grow from seeds.
Wow.
And this plant is only about no more than 3 or 4 years old.
Wow.
Yeah, they grow
so
very
this
fast.
Is from seed, 3 or 4 years old, and it's like, what, almost 10 feet tall?
Yep.
So I want to ask Luke a few more questions, since literally he's the local, I would consider him a local fruit expert, since he takes care of all these over 100 different kinds of different edible plants, and he basically, on a day-to-day basis, wait, do you take a day off? Is the nursery always open?
Yeah, that's something you need to ask my wife, but yeah, we open Monday through Saturday from 9 to 5, and then when the festivals come, like the festival will start soon, then we'll be working 7 days a week for a couple of months. So yeah, no days off soon.
But. Cool. Now, I know a lot of my viewers may not live in the Orlando area. So if you're in the Orlando area, you guys could come out. I said the address in the video earlier. I'll put also a link down below to the website and the address in the show notes. But you want to talk about how you can ship basically most of your plants to anywhere in the United States, provided it's not illegal for your state.
Right. Yeah, so we sell our plants obviously here at festivals around Central Florida, the greater Central Florida. And we also sell on our website, anaturalfarm.com. So most of our plants can be bought directly on our website, on our turmeric roots, ginger roots. And also we have a Etsy website. We have a few plants on Amazon and eBay, but it's mostly our website, anaturalfarm.com, and then our Etsy store under A Natural Farm, one word. Thank you again.
Yeah, so I will say, and you could tell everybody if this is accurate, like, even though they sell a lot of plants here and they'll grow
you know, good in a greenhouse here, and some will grow really fine outside in Orlando. Some of these are more tropical and they may not make it, even if you're going to sell it and ship it to Chicago or Minnesota, right? So you want to maybe talk about that and why people might want to buy some of these tropical plants to grow in Chicago.
Yes.
And how that might work or not work to save people, you know, from a headache and be an unsatisfied customer.
Yeah, so most of the trees you can find here can be grown in a container forever. So you can buy an avocado tree that would normally grow up to North Carolina or coastal South Carolina, but you can grow that same tree in the New York area on your patio in a container, or in Louisiana or North Carolina. So with a little bit more care than we have to worry about here, you can grow any of those fruit trees on the patio, in a container, and with minimal pruning, you can keep most of those fruit trees with a small size and still produce a lot of fruits very easily.
So what would be the minimal care that you're talking about? It'd be like planting in a container and then basically bringing it in well before it gets down to like, 50, 40 degrees or?
Yeah, so basically we have customers that grow our plants in bigger container, and they have casters under the pots, and they will grow them on the garage pad in front of their garage. And if it's gonna grow, if the temperature will go below 40 degrees, then they'll just slide the plants inside the garage. So as long as you can keep your plants and have a system to roll them inside the garage, and then you can do it very easily.
Yeah, and then hopefully you don't travel too much, because if you're not there the day you're supposed to roll them in, you could lose your investment of many years, which I would feel sad. I mean, I think it might be easier if you really want to grow some of these guys. Hey, move down, buy a place here in Orlando, start a food forest, and come to Luke here and buy all your fruit trees and greens to get it started. Any other final comments or words of wisdom you'd like to share, Luke, with my viewers today?
Well, I'm very happy that we got a great surprise of seeing you today. And then hopefully we can, you can always call us. If you can't come here, you can call and we'll be happy to give you all the advice on the phone. And it was great to meet you in person, because I've seen a lot of your videos. And thanks again.
Oh, cool. Well, thank you so much. Thanks for having me today and literally giving me free reign to go around and show everything at your amazing nursery. I hope you stay in business for many years and continue to expand. I hope next time I come in town, which I don't know when that's going to be, is you guys have the barn there. Yeah. And that's all up and running, because I know that's been a process for you. So if some of my viewers out there want to get a hold of you, you want to mention your email, your website, your address, and your phone number and all that stuff, so somebody can get a hold of you if they want to learn more about the trees and amazing plants you have here.
Yeah, so my phone number is 352-536-3112. And our website, again, is anaturalfarm.com, anaturalfarm.com. And our email is anaturalfarm@gmail.com. Thank you.
All right, wonderful. So anyways, I hope all you guys that are watching this episode, do you guys have anything more to say?
Good.
All right, you're good. All right, cool. All right, so I guess that's pretty much it for the episode. It's actually getting dark, and actually I'm just on a one-day layover. Actually, I got to fly back out tonight on my way to Puerto Rico, and be sure to click that subscribe button right down below and click the little bell so you get notified when my new episode's coming out. I'm going to be filming a whole bunch of episodes, hopefully in Puerto Rico. Also be sure to like this video. If you guys like this video, like the content that I produced, it gave you some wealth of knowledge, or maybe even a new resource. If you guys live here in Orlando, I would definitely recommend the nursery here for all your edible trees and edible plants. If they don't have it, they could probably likely get it for you. And in my opinion, one of the suggestions I'll give is they need to carry more leafy green vegetables that they could propagate, and perennials by far. That's maybe a little bit deficient in that category, but they got all the fruit trees that you would ever want and more. Also be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1400 episodes at this time on the YouTube channel, dedicated to teach you guys how to grow your own fruits and vegetables at home. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and until then, remember, keep on growing.